coming from Uppsala University, and also European Office of Aerospace Research and Development and Office of US Military Human Health Factors. I'm coming from a university hospital that is more than 300 years old, and it is very good to be in Italy, that it has traditional, very old neurological system. So I'm very proud. I have to say this because whatever I'm speaking, this is my opinion. It has nothing to do with US military, Swedish government, or any other organization that are involved in my research. I will briefly discuss neuroprotection. Still, we need to understand what is neuroprotection, and people feel normally that we need to protect neurons only. But this is completely wrong, because neurons are only in minority. We have much more higher in number the glial cells, and even higher the endothelial cells. So when we talk about neuronal injury, of course neurons are quite evident, but we need to protect all non-neural cells. So we feel that even non-neural cells are crucial in protecting our nervous system. So I will today focus largely how monoclonal antibodies can help in neuroprotection in some of the animal models that we are working. And briefly, I will also tell you the project that we are working, how we can nano-deliver these drugs or nanoparticles or even antibodies so they can have better effects. As I told you that in our brain we have a very unique system that is blood-brain barrier, and it protects entry to many of the substances from blood to brain. And therefore, obviously, the drug is also not reaching to the brain for therapeutic level. So this could be a problem. And as I told you that it was discovered in Germany, everybody knows, and glial cells and endothelial cells are much more higher in than neurons in the brain, so we must think about the role of non-neural cells as well. I show this cartoon to tell you that the blood-brain barrier is the most toughest one, very tight, although we also have a blood-cerebrospinal fluid barrier, because you inject something in cerebrospinal fluid. Since you are from pharmacology, you know very well, but this barrier is not so much tight. So that is the message from this slide. And the point is that if we are healthy, or we consider our animals or models are healthy, then they have an intact barrier. Even a small molecule tracer, for example, 30 angstrom, cannot penetrate the barrier. But when we have disease, any kind of neuronal injuries or neuronal disease, you can name any, you have a leaky barrier. And this is so large that even plasma proteins can be leaky. And when these proteins enter into the brain, the extracellular or intracellular environment, they produce edema. So we believe that fundamentals of neuroprotection, one should direct our investigations to reduce this barrier breakdown, to reduce swelling of the brain, and these two conditions might help in reducing neuronal injuries as well. The good thing is that various drugs can influence the barrier permeability by itself. This is just showing that when the capillaries are leaky, they can affect not only neurons but glial cells and so many components of the central nervous system, reducing injury and disease. I am basically a neuropathologist with interest in pharmacological modification of pathological brain, because we believe that morphology, we can see if the cells are normal or getting normal after injury, we can really see it. And also we can see that which area some cells are revived and which areas not. So and my mentor is Professor Yngve Olson. He is one of the leading neuropathologists in the world. And then I have opportunity to work with Dr. Servus Navarro in Germany, Berlin. And he has the honor to become not only Bundestag by Chancellor Helmut Kohl at that time, but also he is one of the living legends in neuropathology in Europe. So we believe that any kind of CNS insults affects this blood-brain barrier or blood-central nervous system barrier adversely, can produce edema, necrosis, and ischemia. Also influence different kinds of gene expression leading to cell death. So either we should modulate using pharmacological agents at this level or this level, we can influence cell death. Regarding monoclonal antibodies, I think you as student are very familiar with these antibody system, isn't it? Yeah. Either you are using for immunohistochemistry or many other things or labeling. So here I will not tell much about that. And these are simple cartoons that how one can produce. I'm not going in detail because everybody knows this. The use of antibodies in our society is very old. And I'm not going to read this data, but as you can see that since 1796 and until 1975, even US FDA has approved use of antibodies for therapeutic purposes in human cases. This is an example from 1986 to 2000. US FDA has approved so many antibodies for therapeutic use in patients. So what we believe that one can use the properties of these antibodies to reduce or antagonize some of the endogenous mechanisms in the central nervous system. Here is a long list telling some data that some of the monoclonal antibodies could be much better than the receptor antagonist. The problem is like that. Look, if you consider serotonin, serotonin could have 7 receptors or sub-receptors, so altogether 14 receptors. If serotonin is increased in brain injury or decreased, you want to give a drug. If you are using serotonin synthesis inhibitor, the story is entirely different. All serotonin synthesis will be blocked. But if you are using serotonin receptor, then you have to look 5-HT2, 1-AC, whatsoever it is. It's very complicated. So therefore, but when you apply antibodies, probably it appears that the effect of 5-HT is blocked in the endogenous system as well. So these are the things. So in some cases, these monoclonal antibodies could be much more efficient than the receptor binding levels, and we cannot still tell what kind of receptors they are. So these are some of the data and some of the documents I showed you that antibodies will mimic or act as internal image of the ligand, and therefore they can work or antagonize physiological receptors. And these are some basic aspects that in cancer research monoclonal antibodies are used and they are working in a better way. This is also from the book, and still, monoclonal antibody therapy can be used to destroy malignant tumor cells and prevent tumor growth by blocking the specific cell receptors. So these are the present concepts. And this is an example how this monoclonal antibody can be used as a prodrug and inhibit or kill tumor cells in particular. Okay. Recently approved monoclonal antibodies for treatment in cancer. These are the compounds. And there are different ways how monoclonal antibody can treat cancer. I'm not a cancer specialist. I just took these data to show you that I'm not the first to use monoclonal antibody in animal models. We have just summarized a review in 2008 about use of monoclonal antibodies, and this was quite well received. Now, coming to neurological disorders. I mean, you all know that brain contains millions of factors or neurochemicals or compounds. Whenever injury or disease occurs, it releases so many things. But nature has produced our internal system that when there is an injury, there are also endogenous neuroprotective agents are released. They are within the brain. And when injury or pathology occurs, means there is a disbalance. So I cannot claim that this list is complete by any means, but you see, we know that some are neurodestructive agents like serotonin, bradykinin, histamine, dynorphin, TNF alpha, nitric oxide, carbon monoxide, free radicals, prostaglandins, glutamate, aspartate, and many others. Interestingly, all have effects on blood-brain barrier function. Whereas we have endogenous neuroprotective elements, neurotrophic factors, it could be BDNF, GDNF, IGF-1, CNTF, growth hormone. And therefore, antibodies to many neurodestructive elements can be also neuroprotective. But when we use any pharmacological agent, either we use one compound or stop one factor, where the other factors are not. Although there are crosstalks are available inside. So you must understand that whenever we treat, we are only inhibiting one factor, not the all. And the other point is that all experiments are done in healthy animals. But in human cases, when people have brain injury, it is not necessary that they are healthy. They could have hypertension, they could have diabetes, they are exposed to different kind of environmental nanoparticles. So in those circumstances, our pharmacology will not work. So I will also give you some example in this aspect as well. I will show you briefly the use of antibodies we have done, serotonin, neuronal nitric oxide synthase, dynorphin, and tumor necrosis factor alpha. We have used some models, spinal cord injury, traumatic brain injury, closed head injury, and hyperthermia. So I will show you some aspects of a spinal cord injury where we have used in rats some antibodies. Normally a spinal cord injury can occur like this, and we cannot mimic these human cases of a spinal cord injury in lab anyway. But of course, we can study some of the models. The idea is that in human cases, injury occurs when we are conscious. But in animals, we have to anesthetize and then we make injury. The other difference is that in human cases, spinal cord injury always occurs from ventral side, and all cases of animal studies, spinal cord injury is done on the dorsal side. So these are entirely different aspects, but still we can study some drugs. We cannot replicate the animal model to human cases because there are so many factors we have no control in the human situation. Drug interaction, disease interaction, genetic factors, environmental, emotional, and so many other factors. We must keep these things also in our mind. So this is an animal model of a spinal cord injury. If we don't give any drug, this is spinal cord is looking edematous, microhemorrhage, and swelling. Here we have applied nitric oxide synthase antibodies topically, and you can see that the results are quite different. We have given LM topically and intravenously. You can see the results are different. So the point is that in this model, you can use some drugs, in this case antibodies, to study neuroprotection up to certain period. Any drug can function depending on when you have injected, how long your survival. The drug can protect for only 3-4 hours. Some drug can protect after 24 hours. So these factors are very important. One cannot say that a given drug is always neuroprotective under all conditions. So here is the pathological picture after injury, spinal cord is swollen. And then we have recorded evoked potential, because I will show you something later. In normal situations, the evoked potential, the amplitude is very good, high in both rostral and caudal. If injury is here, after injury, the rostral amplitudes are gone down for certain time, but the caudal are increased. But here we are not discussing the mechanisms behind it. Leakage to advanced blue increases from 1 hour to 12 hour progressively. If we use radioiodine, a small molecule, one can even get leakage at 5 minutes. So depending on what tracer you are using to study barrier function, you can see the changes. Here is electron microscopy and lanthanum is 12 angstrom in diameter, can be seen in the basal lamina here, and also infiltration within the endothelial cells, telling you that blood-brain barrier or blood-spine cord barrier is damaged after injury. And here another example, lanthanum is here and there is edema and swelling. We also use water content to see edema formation can be seen up 5 minutes after injury, and it is progressing up to 12 hours. So opening of the barrier to proteins and edema can go together. This is neuronal injury in your cases as compared to control. And as I told you, glial cells are also activated when there is neuron injury. And in this case, you can see that, even there is difference between left and right side. Myelin-basic protein using immunohistochemistry is degenerated in the injured group as compared to the control. It means that the pathological picture is quite clear in this model. And look what happens. We have applied serotonin antibodies at different dilutions here, and you can see that after application of serotonin antibodies, this is the difference between the picture. Also, you can see here that the spinal cord injury water content is increased in three different segments. Leakage of iodine is quite clear in three different segments. Treatment with 5-ST antibodies significantly reduce these changes, whereas either neutralized antibodies or any other antibodies that are not serotonin here in this case, not working that effectively. I showed you about dynorphin antibodies. If our theory is right, one antibody is working, why not other? Because in human cases or in CNS, many things are released. So we took here dynorphin antibodies 1 to 17, and here you can see that after application of dynorphin antibodies, this is the result after dynorphin antibodies as compared to the untreated group. Even the electrophysiological activities became normal, and also the iodine leakage is less, water content is less. This is the cortic, and this is the water content. All are reduced. These are evoked potentials, amplitude, and latencies. And electron microscopically, you can also see that antibody given over the spinal cord reduce the brain damage, spinal cord damage. Then the idea is that we tried neuronal nitric oxide synthase antibodies. I have shown you the bigger picture. Here, these are the neuronal nitric oxide synthase in untreated group, right and left side. When we have applied dynorphin A anti-serum here, they are also able to reduce nitric oxide synthase upregulation. So this is the idea that any neuroprotective compounds, if given, can be able to reduce those things that may not be directly connected. That was the knowledge at that time. And this is the same thing when we have given nitric oxide synthase antibodies. Also, the upregulation of nitric oxide synthase was not seen. It means that the antibody is penetrating in the spinal cord and able to thwart the changes or upregulation of nitric oxide synthase. Then we have used TNF-alpha anti-serum, and as I told you that everything depends on the time and survival of the administration. So here, when interesting finding is that when TNF-alpha was given, antibodies given 30 minutes before, in normal cases, we could not see neuroprotection. Up to minus 30 minutes to 10 minutes. But when we have given after 30 minutes, we can see some neuroprotection. It means that this is not the controversy. Probably the normal maintenance of TNF-alpha is necessary in the system. And these are the example here you can see. And also, we have related to this upregulation of nitric oxide synthase. When TNF-alpha antibody is given 30 minutes, there is neuroprotection. It is also able to block nitric oxide synthase upregulation. Then the question is, can we enhance this neuroprotection by combination of different antibodies? And the answer is yes. Here we have given tumor necrosis factor alpha and nitric oxide synthase antibodies. And we can see that one can prolong the period of neuroprotection, because in these cases, nitric oxide synthase antibodies was given 5 minutes after, TNF-alpha was given 30 minutes after. We can see protection up to 5 hours. But if the combination was given even after 1 hour, the combination is working. And these are the same some examples here. I showed you in color here, nitric oxide synthase, gone. And here is nitric oxide synthase is much less regulated if given TNF-alpha. And here is the correlation that we put, that at T9 level, the correlation of neuronal injury and nitric oxide synthase upregulation was much more tight than the T12 level. We still do not know what are the mechanisms that can regulate the neuronal changes above and below the lesion. This is another example of traumatic brain injury. Here, this is the model, a unilateral incision of the spine, cerebral cortex. After application of nitric oxide synthase, here you can see that it is protected as compared to the untreated. And here the light and electron microscopic evidence, nitric oxide synthase was also down-regulated in the cortex here. And electron microscopy can see that there is no leakage here. and the neuropathy is quite preserved. This is also the case in this case. Then one of our students is working on closed head injury model and applying different kinds of antibodies. I don't have much time, so I will briefly go through this work. And closed head injury where the skull is not fractured, but it can produce different kinds of morbidity and functional abnormalities. And here, there are so many reasons to tell that serotonin as one of the compound is altered and it has interaction with many other factors. So this is the model, this is the impact one. And no skull is fractured. When serotonin anti-serum was given, you can see that in this model, if you have injury on right side, the left side is much more damaged. So this is the model of counter coup. And here you can see here that serotonin antibodies can protect brain injury that was more prominent towards left side than right side. Some of the data, here is the injury side and uninjured side, serotonin antibodies given. You can see blood-brain barrier permeability is much more less as compared to the untreated group here, to both Evans group and radial iodine. The same thing with brain edema. This is the injury side where treated, right and left side were much more less than the right and left side in untreated group. Here is the cerebral blood flow, and you can see that they were much more higher in both sides in antibodies treated group as compared to the untreated. I'm not showing the functional parameters, but they were also improved. The point is that if given 30 minutes before, we have the best result. After 30 minutes, it's also acceptable. But if given 60 minutes after, there is no effect. So we have to understand the timing. And what it does, it also reduces nitric oxide expression synthase, histamine, and even COX-2 expression. So there is an interrelation of things when you produce antibodies. This can give you one thing, that antibodies are working in vivo and producing these changes endogenously. That could be beneficial, or in certain cases, if they are given after, they are also could be harmful too. So now we are thinking also, this is a project we are working with US military. We are delivering these antibodies with titanium nanowire tag. And some of the results I can only mention briefly because some of the results are classified, but I can only give you some idea. And this was the work for Dr. Banum Reddy, and I can show you we have composed a book, Progress in Brain Research on Nanoneuroscience and Nanoneuropharmacology, in 2009. And of course, this is Dr. Aaron Shikanova, chemistry Nobel laureate in 2004. We have discussion about nanodrug delivery, and he's very positive to our idea. He's working from Israel. We have produced this book for this International Review of Neurobiology, where we have given the concept of nanowiring. It is in a chapter written by different experts. And this is another Nobel laureate, Dr. Shelley, who worked physiology and medicine prize in 1977. We are working with nanowiring of CRF, on which he got the Nobel Prize. So this is one of the carbon nanotube where drugs can be labeled and administered. And this is Dr. Ryan Tiam, and this is Dr. Wang. They work in Arkansas Fayetteville. They are have the patent of nanowiring. We are using their nanowires to deliver the drugs. And you can see, I'm showing only this example, that even stem cells can be nanowired. And if given, they can survive longer periods and they can have better effects. This is an example you can see. And since these are very costly experiments, so we have support from Governor of Arkansas, he is sitting Governor of Arkansas, social Democrat, my BB, but we are not doing any politics. So I can show you some of the examples for those that I can show you. This is a drug called Cerebralizin. It is manufactured in Austria, and it is a mixture of different kinds of neurotrophic factors. I told you, one compound cannot be treatment for all. So this was very ideal because it's a different property. It's neuronal survival, neuroprotection, neuroplasticity, and neurogenesis. It has a mixture of 20 types of neurotrophic factors, small active peptides. And we have some preliminary publications with different types of brain trauma. We used nanowiring of titanium, 20 nanometer in size, and this looks like this. And we are working with Dr. William Slicker. He is the director of USFDA at Jefferson. And you can see I'm showing some examples in Alzheimer's model of animals, this transgenic mice. You can see that nanowire cellulosing when given, it has reduced the upregulation of amyloid beta in the brain. And this is the example when we have measured the normal cellulosing has reduced, but the nanowire cellulosing has best effect. So it shows that nanowire cellulosing or nanowire drug delivery of antibodies can be very beneficial. And we are very happy that our former Prime Minister from Sweden is also helping us in this area. And on this work, Dr. Anthony Marmolao Award was given to us, working on blood-brain barrier in Japan. I will briefly now tell you some of the work in 10 minutes by our colleague from Romania. He is a clinical neurologist, Dafi Nuresanu. And the idea is that if antibodies are working in the spinal cord injury, in brain injury, it should also work in another model of hypothalamic brain. And here we have used TNF-alpha antibodies. The point is that if the animals are hypertensive, can we use the same kind of drug in similar pattern? My answer is no, at least that is emerging from this investigation. So I will show you that heat stress, if given 38 degrees for 4 hours, can increase the body temperature clinically. And in this case, there is a tight correlation between breakdown of the blood-brain barrier and kidney malformation. This is the leakage of Evans flow after 4 hour heat stress in different brain. At this time, 4 hour, the EEG signals were much slowed down by slowing of the brain in causing brain injury. And there is a regional increase in blood-brain barrier and a regional decrease in cerebral blood flow. So this is a model that provides brain pathology in hyperthermia. And here is the normal animal's lanthanum is confined into the human. And here you can see in heat stress, this is the leakage, massive leakage of lanthanum in and around the tight junction, although the tight junctions are intact. This hyperthermia especially produces hippocampus damage apart from other areas. And the most interesting finding is that the damage is much more intense in the CA4 area. You know, in this ischemia, it is CA1. But in hyperthermia, this is CA4 that is much more damaged. And also, the blood-CSF barrier is also broken down in such situations. Electron microscopy, you can see one neuron is very dark, and there is so many damages here. Since I am pathologist, I am showing you some morphological images. Each of protein upregulation can be seen. So this is a perfect model where we can see brain pathology in hyperthermia. Now the question is that if animals were normal and they were subjected to hyperthermia, we can get one result. If the animals are hypertensive and subjected to hyperthermia, the damage is much more extensive. So these are some previous publications I'm not going through. So the idea is that if TNF-alpha antibodies can reduce cell injury, what will happen in hypertensive or normal tensive rats? They are equally protected. And here is the interesting finding. This is the method that we produced one clear hypertension. And here you can see the interesting finding. 4 hour heat stress normotensive, there is a leakage of iodine, brain edema, and upregulation of neural nitric oxide synthase and neuronal injury. Hypertensive rats, they show much more higher increase in neuronal injury. Now the point is here, when TNF-alpha we are given to normotensive animals, 30 minutes after, there is very nice neuroprotection. But when they were given in hypertensive animals after 30 minutes, there is an adverse or opposite result. We still do not know how and why. But when this TNF-alpha in these cases were given 60 minutes after, there is quite good normotensive, quite good, still neuroprotection. 60 minutes after when they're given in hypertension, there is much more damage. So what happens? That in hypertensive animals, I will show you. Here you see that when they were given minus 30 minutes in hypertensive animals, there is good. But in minus 30 minutes, in normotensive animals, there was no protection. So probably the hypertension